Dear friends in Christ, indeed our God is amazing, and may the full assurance that he can do all things guard and keep you now and always. Amen. This week we had a busy week here at Grace, and as I've mentioned, and as you know, as you've seen the posters, we had our Vacation Bible School, an opportunity to share the gospel with kids from our church, kids from outside of our church, and kids from our community. And we give thanks to the Lord for that opportunity, because all throughout that week, we sang songs, we had an important theme verse that reminded us that we need to trust God in all things. Now this seems like something that's just kid stuff, right? That we can just trust God in all things. In fact, just before our gospel reading for today, Jesus said, have faith like a child and trust God. But sometimes I think that it's even as children, it can be difficult to trust God in all things. It can be hard for us to not worry, to not be afraid, to not be scared. As we went through the week, the kids had opportunity to share things that sometimes made them scared or afraid. And as we look at them, that we might say they're a bit irrational, but maybe we remember when we were raising our children, and you can think about when they came screaming into your bedroom, Mommy, Daddy, I had a bad dream, a nightmare. And you cuddled them in, and you said, don't worry, it's just a dream. Or maybe you remember having to lead your granddaughter or grandson into their bedroom and telling them, there's no boogeyman in the closet, I promise. There's no boogeyman under your bed, don't worry. Maybe you remember that as you were growing up, maybe you turned on all the lights in your room and turned on all the lights in your closet just to make sure that there wasn't anybody hiding out and because you were afraid of the dark. These may seem irrational to us, but even to this day, we know that some of these fears are, well, we still experience them a little bit, don't we? I'm sure you've woken up with a bit of a cold sweat after a bad dream. For some reason, I keep getting plagued with this dream about church not being ready, that I come out and I, for some reason, forgot my robe and I have to go back, and when I come back out here, you guys are gone. I always wake up in a cold sweat and think, oh, it was just a dream, but still, I have those dreams, and I'm sure some of you still turn on all the lights in your house right before you go to bed just to make sure there's no one hiding out in the corner. Another, hate to admit this, but another maybe irrational fear I have is climbing ladders. For some reason, I have this fear of falling, or at least a fear of that sudden landing at the end. So whenever I climb a ladder, my hands sweat, my knees shake, and it's hard for me to get up there or to come to the edge of a roof, and maybe some of you guys know what I'm talking about. Because you know what, I'm sure you do, because you've had different fears in your lives, different things that, whether rational or irrational, that you've had to conquer, that you had to get over. There's that old cliche, though, that there's nothing to fear but fear itself. But how often do we struggle with that? How often do we struggle to conquer those fears in our lives, to just completely turn our back on those fears? We know, as irrational as many of those fears are, that we still have them. And even beyond that, we have many fears that continue to hold us captive in our lives. Many worries that will keep us awake at night. Things that we still struggle with. Some of you, I'm sure, worry about where your sons and daughters are. As you lay in bed at 3:19 in the morning, wishing you knew exactly that they were safe, that they were okay, or your grandkids. Some of you worry about whether you're going to pay the electric bill this month or pay the food or put food on your table this month. Some of you worry about whether or not people are going to like you or not, or whether or not you're going to ever get out from behind the shadow of your parents. Some of you worry about whether you've sinned too much, whether there's a way that the sins in your life could ever be conquered. Some of you worry for your salvation. You think to yourself, was this time too many? Could God really forgive me for doing that? You know that there are things that you worry about, aren't there? Things that keep you awake at night, things that you struggle with, things that are burdens on your heart. Some of them rational, some of them irrational. Some of them things that are yet to come, some of them things that have already happened. Just think about your own life. What fears do you have right now? What concerns do you have? As you think about it, I don't think any one of us can say, I don't have any fears, I don't have any concerns. I wish that were the case, but we live in the real world, don't we? We live in a world that is full of worries and fears and concerns. We live in a world where, as much as we hear the children shout in all things, trust God, we maybe shrink back a little and we say, well, yeah, in all things, trust God, but. Or we hear those words of Jesus today to the disciples, and maybe we get a little squeamish because he says, what is impossible with men is possible with God. Beautiful news. great to know in our minds, but sometimes harder to know in our hearts, isn't it? Even the disciples, they were wrestling with this, weren't they? Let's go back to our lesson from Mark today. If you have your bulletin in front of you, look again at Mark chapter 10. Here, this rich man had approached Jesus. He thought he had done everything well. He even called Jesus good teacher. He goes through and Jesus lists off the commandments. That rich young man, he puffs up his chest a little bit. He says, done them all. I've done a great job. I've kept them all. Don't worry, Jesus. I'm good to go. Jesus says, sell everything you have. Then follow me. And the rich young man went away dejected, brokenhearted. But Jesus wasn't saying, with God, all things are possible just to him, but to the disciples, because the disciples saw this. They saw this rich young man who'd done such a good job keeping the law, now walking away with his head down. And they said, Lord, how can it be possible that anybody would be saved if this rich young man who did such a good job couldn't be saved? And that's when Jesus said that promise. He didn't say, don't worry, God's going to forget about it, or don't worry, it's going to be all right. He said something so much more important. With God, with man, things are impossible. With God, all things are possible, because everything is possible with our God. Even forgiving someone who is dead in their sins, even bringing life to each one of us who are dead in our trespasses, giving us new life. For we know that is the promise that we have. That is the promise that we know. That's the promise that was given to us at our baptism. Mark 16:16. Whoever believes and is baptized shall be saved. Not may be saved, not on Tuesday we'll be saved, but shall be saved. We are saved by the blood of Christ Jesus, by his blood on the cross. We are forgiven of our sins, and we are made right before God. And so even as we have many fears in our lives, that is one fear that should never plague us. That is one fear that we should put behind us, because we have nothing to fear in terms of our salvation. We have nothing to fear really in all of creation. And we shouldn't fear anything. We shouldn't be afraid. But notice I use that word shouldn't. Easier said than done, isn't it? It's easier to say that we shouldn't be afraid or shouldn't be scared than to actually live that, isn't it? It's easier to make that confession, I trust God in all things, than to indeed trust God in all things. We know everything is possible with God, but we struggle with that. We struggle with that truth in our lives. When I was growing up, my dad used to often say to me, worry is sinful. Take it to the Savior and stop it. And while that's not directly in the Bible, and I didn't know exactly what he meant when he first said it, it is biblical. See, when he said that, I understood, okay, worry is sinful, but I didn't know why. Why is worry sinful? Why is worry in my life sinful? Shouldn't I be concerned about tomorrow? Shouldn't I be concerned about what is to come? Well, that's not what my dad was saying. That's not what Scripture is saying. We should be concerned about what is to come. We should be prepared in season and out. But that's what my dad was saying there, what Scripture says, what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 6, is that worry, it's not trusting in God fully. Worry is not completely being faithful. Worry is turning into ourselves, thinking that something is possible with us. Worry is bound up in what we do and what we say and who we are, and rather than in what God has done for us. In Matthew 6, Jesus goes through, he spends much of the chapter, and I encourage you to look in Matthew 6 later, but he spends much of the chapter talking about that issue of worry. He says, don't worry. Don't worry, it's not going to help anyway. But instead, give me your worries. He says that a little later, actually, in Matthew. But he says, cast your burdens onto me, for I care for you. See, worry is actually a tool of the devil. Worry is a tool that Satan uses to distract us from God, to imprison us, to take us away from God. Worry is a tool that Satan uses to drag us away. So instead of focusing on what God does, we focus on who we are. Because he knows when we focus on who we are, it's pretty hopeless, isn't it? When we focus on what we have done, even as Christian people, it's pretty hopeless, isn't it? When we take a long look at ourselves, we know that there are sins that continue to plague us. We know that worry continues to live in our lives each day, whether it's rational or not. We know that worry is not under our control. And when Satan does that, he imprisons us. He locks us up. He locks us inside ourselves because he knows. He knows what happens to a Christian who isn't worried. He knows what happens to a Christian who is not afraid. Before we get into that real quick, I want to share with you a verse that Paul wrote. He wrote this in Philippians 4, just right at the end of our reading for today. I know what it is to be in need. I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Say that with me. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. I got to be honest, the kids have you beat on that one, but that's okay. As long as you learn that and write it on your heart, rather. But back to where I was going with that. Here, Paul, he was really imprisoned. He was in the Mamertine dungeon, the one of the worst of the worst. It wasn't a question of when you'd get out of there, at least alive. It was a question of when you would die in there. And he wrote those words from there. He wrote those words in Philippians chapter 4, imprisoned in a dungeon where he could barely see light to write. He wrote those words of confidence in his God because he was not worried about himself. He was not worried about what tomorrow would bring. He wasn't worried about what was in this world. But he was looking forward to what was to come. He was looking forward to the promise of salvation that he had. He was looking forward to the promise of salvation that we have. See, the worries that we have in this life, they're temporary. The worries that plague us now, they're short term. The worries that keep us away from completely trusting in God and peace in God now, they're going to come to an end. And you know in your life that these come to an end in our life and then in the life that is to come because God has prepared a place for us. He's prepared a place for us not here in this world in a world full of worries, but in a world without worry, without fear, in his very presence. He's prepared a place for us not as slaves, not as beggars, but as his sons and daughters, as we have been brought in through our baptism. He has given us that promise, and that is the promise that we need not be afraid or need not worry, but we may hope in the Lord. And as Christians who hope in the Lord, it turns our lives around. Because Christians who are worried are turned in, but Christians who are hoping in the Lord are turned out. They are not turned in for what is benefiting them, but they are looking out into what God has in mind, to what God desires. And when we look at what God desires, he's not worried. He sees a world that's destroyed by sin. He sees a world that's destroyed by death. And he still sent his son. He still sent Jesus into the world, a world that he knew would reject him. He still sent his son because he knew that he had power over sin, death, and the devil. He sent his son into the world because he knew that Jesus would indeed defeat sin in our lives, that Jesus would defeat death, and that he would conquer the devil so that we would one day be with him forever. That is the hope that we have as Christians. That is the hope that we have to carry into the world. That is the hope that goes beyond these walls because so often we are worried. We are caught up in these walls. We take shelter. We duck low. We build up our barricade. But we're just imprisoning ourselves. Jesus breaks through those walls of imprisonment. Jesus tears them down and he frees us. He frees us that we might share the good news. So that we might share the good news with a world who is still dying. With a world that is corrupted by sin. But a world that he has hope for. He wouldn't send us out if he didn't have hope. Or rather, confidence. See, our God doesn't look at the present. He doesn't look at the past. He doesn't even look at the future. He looks at it all at once and he sees that we are a world in need of salvation in the past, in the present, in the end, in the future. And so when Jesus died on the cross, it wasn't just for those who believe now, but it was for all people, so that all might be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And he's given us the promise that no matter who we are, no matter where we are, no matter what people do to us, that we can trust him. Because everything is possible through our God. Everything is possible through him who conquered death. And everything is possible as we go out in the world. Because he walks with us. He leads us on the way. He gives us the strength we need. He gives us the support. And he gives us the promise that one day we will walk with him in eternity. And that is the hope we have as Christians. That is the hope that we have because everything is possible with our God. Amen. Please pray with me. Gracious God, we know that at times we do not trust. We know that at times our worries and our fears, they overcome us. We know that at times that we turn our back on you. We pray, Lord, that you would send your Holy Spirit into our lives, that he would lead us to forgiveness, that he would lead us to the strength and support that comes in your holy word. Lord, walk with us and talk with us. Lead us and guide us that we may go forth with your word, that we may not be afraid, but we may go knowing that none of our fears are consequential, but they will cease. They are temporary. They will come to an end. Lord, give us the sure hope of the promise that will never come to an end, the sure hope that we have in knowing eternal life with you, that forever life that we have in your presence. Lord, we pray that we would trust that we can do all things through you who give us strength. May this be the words that are written on our hearts. May this be the words that we go forth with. And may this be the words that lead us and guide us to the hope that we have one day with you forever in heaven. This we pray in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.